We can start our TGIF talk. Yeah, this is our last talk, and this is our, I would say, special talk because it's the 10th talk on the PGCon conferences. So every year we made a talk, sometimes we made two talks, so now we have, this is our 10th talk, and each time we present something new, some of our development. And that time we will talk about our new version of HStore, which is nested now and has arrays, support of arrays. Here's if you don't know us, is our pictures made in the time when we started working with GIST. Yeah, so we are here more or less young. Yeah. Yeah, yeah. And if people don't know who we are working with the extendability of Postgres and do full text search, L3, and other interesting extensions. So here's the agenda. So we'll talk about what is HStore, just to remind, just one slide. Then mention history of HStore development. We'll talk about internals and some limitations. And then we just very quickly show what operators and functions available, some new. Then we stop on the performance study, summary, and what we plan to do. So this is introduction of to HStore. HStore is a collection of k-value pairs, where the k and value just strings. This is very simple. But it happens, it becomes very useful for people. And we provide several operators which to get a value for k, some operators with index support check for k and contain. And there are more functions and operators available. We'll not talk about right now. We have also provide a bunch of functions to HStore. So basically, this is old HStore, which is currently available in the Postgres distribution. Interesting, yesterday night, I just interesting what Google Trends knows about HStore. And for my, I was surprised that Google Trends, indeed, it knows about HStore. Here is HStore and JSON. So, JSON and PostgreSQL, yes, of course. So we see that there is some growing interest for to JSON, and HStore gain some more interest in compare because of JSON. Because JSON users, they understand that, okay, for now we can use HStore if they need some more efficient work. So we see HStore started interest, and what's surprising to me that. People looking from USA, mostly interested in HStore. I think that other people just know and don't. So here's I found in my archive. I found the first email from Theodor Sigaev. It's May 16. It's 10 years ago. Theodor sent me an email. Email about the first version. It's a Russian. So the first version of HStore is ready. Yeah, the history was that we that time we designed a database for the Ministry of Education of Russian Russian Ministry of Education. We designed a database which contains information about the objects of the about the school, colleges, institutes, universities, so many many objects. They all have more or less similar structure. But every object has some specific attributes. So when we tried to make the common table, we found that there are 500 attributes. Mm-hmm. Yeah, and I was very boring to work with in the PSQL with 500 attributes. Mm-hmm. And we, that May 16, we just stay in our special place where we smoke and discuss with Theodor what to do with this. Then we come with the idea of the Perl hash. So just hide all attributes to the all garbage to the to the string, yes. And then after several hours, Theodor sent me the first version. Yeah, so now we have we celebrated 10 years of HStore. Yes. And yeah. And HStore benefits, it's clear, it's a flexible model for storing semi-structured data in relational database, and it is indeed it's very flexible. You can add any fields. You don't need alter table, you don't need lock table, just add another attribute. Of course, it's you can get a lot of garbage, so we get a request here. People need some functions to vacuum HStore to remove all keys without values, for example. But HStore has a drawback, so because it's too simple. It's a k-value model and doesn't support tree-like structures like JSON. But let me notice that JSON was a standard introduced in 3 years after HStore. So if we knew JSON, if JSON was introduced in that time, maybe we could, maybe we implemented JSON that time. So now we have JSON and HStore. And here's HStore versus JSON. So we have from 9.0, we have a JSON in PostgreSQL, which support document-based model. But it is slow because it has no binary representation, and it's just a string. So every time you want to access some attribute from JSON, you have to parse this string. So this is obviously slow. HStore is fast because it has a binary representation, and it has index support. What? It is possible to convert HStore to JSON and vice versa, but since current HStore is limited to K value, so it's maybe not very useful for JSON users. So we decided to develop HStore to add support of document-based model. So its binary representation can be shared with JSON in the future. So we, because for us, it's much easier to work with HStore than with JSON, because JSON is a core, is in core. HStore is an extension model, so we can do more.
Actually, we don't use JavaScript.
So
JSON is not closed for us.
Yeah, so for us, it's closed. HStore, the code base is more or less familiar for us, so we try to work with HStore. But as I said, then it is possible to use this binary representation with JSON. And here is a history of development. As I said, the first unpublished version of HStore was designed for Postgres 7.3. Then Hubert, Mr. Waiting For, posted in the hackers mailing list that there is a HStore model from two Russian guys. I use it several years. Why not to have in the Postgres distribution? So for 8.2, it was included to the PostgreSQL distribution.
Actually, we didn't suggest to include initially because we are afraid the reaction of hackers because it's not relational.
Yeah. So we have it now web page and never published, never advertised, but people somehow get know. Yes. So in PGCon we did a presentation about gene index, and HStore was an application of gene index. So gene index support appears in 8.3. And then HStore got attention from the community, and Andrew improved HStore, so he, because our version has some limitation for the size, for example, and Andrew did.
Kilobytes per value or per record.
Yeah. Now HStore can be very, very big. Yeah. So it's for 9.0. And today we're presenting nested HStore and the transition from K-value model to the document-based model. We hope that it will be available for 9.4. We'll see. So here's the HStore syntax. We have a hash-like HStore, and we have array-like.
it's mostly looks like now, but new that it's allow with the curly brackets around it.
Mm-hmm.
And we have totally re-implemented parser of HStor with Flexi Bison and Bison. So it's easy to some add new much more easy to add some new features.
Mm-hmm. And also we have Array-like. So let's hit the question. What do you mean? Is it array or hash?
Hash.
No.
It's array with one element string, A equal.
Yeah. Okay.
Some cryptic looks sometimes.
Uh-huh. And so also we can have a combination of hash-like and array-like. So here's the HStor. So now we see this.
Look again. It's array. First element is a hash. Second element is array. And the third element is a hash, which value is
an array.
An array.
Yeah. So for nesting HStor, we also always require brackets and braces. So.
Decoration.
And
white curly braces and square braces, again, curly braces. There is different tradition. For example, most of computer languages like C, like Perl, JavaScript uses square braces notation, but PostgreSQL uses curly braces. So
we accept all kind of braces. No, for output we'll take
several slides.
Yeah, this is for input. This is for input. For output we have also
magic.
Yeah. So here we can go into the HStor internals. So HStor consists of Varlena header, so it's the links. We have a number of pairs. It's a K value.
The current implementation, current internals, so just to be clear after
what we did.
And so it has a new version flag introduced by
Andrew.
To easify upgrade from old version of HStor, initial version of HStor to current one.
Yeah.
If this flag is absent, that it's old version. And we need to some transform to this
current version.
Yes, okay, this version. And it's 4-byte long, number of pairs, following fixed size structure H entry, and one H entry it's for K and one for
value.
So two H entries for one pair. And
I'm sorry.
And the array of strings, just the actual value of keys and values. So I don't know how to differentiate the values and values.
Yeah.
Each entry inside 2 bits is reserved for the. For first H entry, just to sometimes it's very comfortable inside the code to have a pointer. And when we have a pointer to the H entry, sometimes we need to know is it first or not. So Andrew introduced 1 bit for the is first and 1 bit for is known. Two reserved bits in each H entry. So size of limit. A limit of size of key or value is 1 gigabyte. Large enough, I suppose. In summary, we see more complex scheme. We see Varlena header again, number of pairs, H entry array, key value, and string array with actual values. and easy to access to the key, first key started from the beginning. And then we just need to remember that each entry, sorry, I didn't say on this slide, that this is position relative to the begin of string and the position of end of value, not the beginning. So first k started from zero, and the end of k is h is the value of first h entry. And so easy to find any actual value just to have a number of pairs in the this array. Pairs all lexicographically ordered by keys. Nested, what changed? First, we took to another bits. We keep new version flag, and we already show that HTOR could be hash-like or array-like. And so we need to store these bits to know what's following. And it's is array bit set that it's number of elements. And the opposite case, it's NPS. One of these bits should be actually set. Never both and never no one. H entry, again, two bits. Add only one bit, so three bits we take for the our flags. Only one new flags is nested. It's pointed that this H entry contains another H store. Not the string value, just another H store value. So, summary. Very similar to current implementation, but there is three flags in the in pairs or NLM. Three flags is first is null is nest for the H entry, and the LM value now could be another H store, but H store should be aligned. So optionally we will have aligned bytes. Nested H store, 103 bytes. Access the same. The same, there is no problem. We need to value of H entry begins from the previous one, and H entry contains the end of H entry. For complex value, we need int align start. For complicated value, for nested value, we need to align start of that.
Some misprints.
Ah? Sorry?
Okay. Doesn't matter.
So.
So we have from this internal representation, from this is a description of a binary representation, and we have a unlimited levels. Actually, we never store levels, so it's virtually unlimited. Number of elements in array, it's 229. Number of pairs, lengths, and length of nested hash of array, so it's quite big. It's a half of gigabyte still. In principle, we can do it bigger.
Maybe.
Yeah. But it should be okay. So the compatibility.
We should start a new representation because it's very easy to upgrade. It's friendly to PG upgrade.
Yeah,
because
so nothing to do.
Each story with two is array and is hash bits are zero, then it's old. New old version of H store, and we can just set
well, gene index also no problem because we just add we use k value notation. You know, we add to the key we add character k, to the value we add character value. because we index separately. Now we add additional E, it means element. So we also have no problem with upgrade here. We have problem with the gist, because old version does not use this notation. So gist indexes should be recreated.
No way to replace upgrade.
So we, after you know the some internals, we continue our HStore syntax. So this is also, you see this syntax, and we have curly braces, a lot of curly braces, and we have a good variable. So array square brackets, false, true. So if it's true, then we use a, for output, we use a square bracket. By default, we use curly brackets, like in Postgres. But if you are Perl users, you can just set this variable.
One thing, it is just for output. Not for internal representation, not for parser. So it's the same, identically, HStore 2 HStore are the same.
We have another two good variables, because should we need braces to embed HStore into the braces? It's root array decorated. It's default, it's true. But you can set it false, so we'll not have additional braces. And hash decorated the same. So. Doesn't require
braces. Symmetrical.
To have a choice how to make the output. Sorry? Because we try to satisfy all people, you know.
So satisfy no one.
There is one more. The same output function inside is used for transformation from HStore to JSON. And then it's, this variable it's free for us. Anybody
it's not people who are trying to read.
For us.
Yeah. We need to make choose. It's to make choice.
Yeah.
Who yeah. Whom to respect? Yeah, we have a pretty print.
Yeah,
we have a pretty print. We have a also another good variable, because most time you don't need pretty print. But when you're working with a really complex structure, you need this just to see. So you need the level.
But if I'm forced to interpret the text representation, it would be nice to only have to write one parser.
Well, no, you only need one parser. If I understand correctly, all of these formats are still unambiguous. So it's just that
well, it's just more complicated.
Well, yeah.
Where? Here?
If you
yeah, yes, if you
change if the arrow to a colon and use brackets for arrays,
JSON will be
some
later.
Then it would be
yeah.
It would just be JSON.
Yeah. So here's a pretty print. And now we talk about operators and functions. The old, we say it's a row operator. We say in Russian, стрелочка. It's a get value by k. Now k you can be so like a simple return text. And now we have another operator. It's a percent row, which returns a store. And that is very interesting because it allows you to make a chaining operators. So you apply this operator, and then you can chain another operators because it outputs is HStore. So another, we add like a JSON, we added get value bypass. So here's a array. Here's an array. So you can specify array and return is like as a text or also as a HStore. You can get array element by index. It's like a text or, you see, the one, you can specify a negative integer, so it can be from the end of array. You can get array by index and get H store. Here is a space is important because if you, because of parser problem. Yeah. So we can chain operators to go deep. So for example, we can get a value for the KB and then go for KC. Or just use like this one, you see. So chaining operators. Because we need something to go deep. Mm-hmm. Don't laugh. This is, you know, you want some support of complex structure, so it is very difficult to work with complex structures. We need some query language, you know. Here's we are working with operators. Here's a concatenation to H store. It's like a old style, and we can concatenate with path.
This value of KB replaces this value.
It's an old behavior, yes. And concatenation with paths works like this. Mm-hmm. It's a
yes, we found this
path and
B and add to this array and add value one.
Value one. Also, we can, if we specify empty path, it will work like a old behavior. Very useful contains operator. It also goes deep. So we can use. Yeah. So I think that you understand how it works. Yeah. And just check if this H store contains in this H store.
Yes, contains means there is a K A, and the A value of K A is an array. Yes, and in array there is a hash with K C with value 3. Yes.
Yeah. Yeah. Oh, it's at first time it looks difficult, but when we
cryptic,
but when we work on the presentation, we eventually understand what we did. Yeah. And we have a old version. We have a SVALS. Avals, now we have a hvals, which returns set of hstore. So, and we can use this function, for example, to get the specific tag. And so this is also interesting. Here is a hvals. It also support path. Null.
Which means asterisk any.
It's like a wild card. So we don't bother about the. We just know that we it is a second level of nesting.
Yes. In this example, we see in array, each element is a
hash
and contains key tags. So we need. In this path, we ask it any. Element of array and extract value of key tags. So result this one and this three.
Yeah, and the same works like with the S vowels, but it returns like as a text. We have replace operator, which also work with path. So we use this path to go to come to the C. And replace to the BD. Yes, we now instead this array we have just one. It's easy. Now we have a HSTOR in JSON conversion. We have two functions. It's HSTOR to JSON and JSON to HSTOR. It works, and we use it for casting, so we can cast like this. Yes, but there is some problem because HSTOR doesn't support types, while JSON does support types. So we can get some problem if we casting number to the HSTOR and back to JSON. So we get from the number we get a string, and from the single value we get a array. So this is a problem with casting. Pretty print also works with HSTOR to JSON, so we can use it for to make your life easy to understand what happens. There are more operators and functions available. We just had no time and to list all functions operators. Yeah. Yes. So maybe most interesting is our performance evaluations. So first we did a test on the synthetical on generated data, but generated data are not very interesting. So I found delicious bookmarks. It's more than 1 million bookmarks in JSON format, which I using JSON to HSTOR convert to the HSTOR format, and the same bookmarks we treat like a text, so we have tested three different formats. All tests I run on my desktop machine. It's 8 gigabyte RAM, and there are many other processors working. It's just my desktop, yes. So what we tested? We tested input performance, so we copy data to table. So we tested access performance, just how fast is getting value by K. And we tested search performance. It's using contains operator. So here's the data. And we see that, of course, HSTOR is a bit bigger. And JSON and text, surprisingly equal, have the same size. Here is the example of the data. It's a delicious bookmark. So we see that it's rather complex and rich data, real life. And we did a copy data as text, JSON, and HSTOR, like very simple command. So for text, we get a 57 seconds, JSON a bit slower, and HSTOR is the slowest. So we know that there are some problem and there is some room to speed up. Theodor can explain the problem with Flex. Yes.
Flex needs to 2 seconds bytes set to zero. When we got C string to parse, we have only one zero bytes in the end. So we need to make a copy of string before parsing.
Yeah. So we can improve this speed up. performance. Yes.
And another thing which we cannot remove that HTOR, the parser of HTOR that lose unreal work, for example, order decay
sorting.
In
yeah. But we see that JSON parser is very fast. But I think that we can do maybe 10%, maybe we can win. Access performance. So we get some base number. It's just select all data from the table. It's for HTOR we use this select. For JSON we use like this the same select, and also Sasha Korotkov wrote this regexp, so we can use it to just to compare, and we see the numbers. So base number is less is the win. HTOR the second one, JSON it's 11 seconds, and regexp is not so far from JSON. So we see that HTOR is quite fast, and it is actually it's about 5 times faster than JSON. It's because of binary representation. So,
why 50 faster? Because we
subtract
the time of reading of data. Uh-huh.
So this is very serious. 50 times it's serious. Now we test the search performance. So contains we have for HTOR we test sexcan, we gist index, gene index, and here is how it looks select for HTOR. For JSON we made the estimation gist and gene index with functional index using JSON to HTOR function. Yes, estimation because I don't know how to look in the all arrays in JSON, so I just use the first element. Yes, so actual time should be bigger, so this is just estimation. Yes, and here's the result. So for HTOR, this is time of create index. Well, of course, gist index is much faster than gene because of the nature. And the size of gist also very small in comparison with the gene. But performance is, we see that gist produces 3 times performance and gene 10 times faster. It's 1/10 of seconds. For JSON, we have create index a bit slower because of the function.
Function was a transformation from
JSON to HTOR. And estimation runs, it's 12 seconds. GIS gives 2 seconds, and GIN, of course, the same. So 2 seconds is because GIS is a lossy index. So we have a recheck phase, recheck. And in the recheck calls a lot of JSON to HTOR function. So GIS is not good for JSON here. We use a Russian doll tree, RD tree, signature tree. Yes. But still, we have, with these functional indexes, we have 6 times faster than estimation. And gene, especially gene, is more than 2 orders of magnitude faster. So JSON users can be happy to use this. Yes?
What's the size of the table?
I already.
No, in bytes. Ah. Okay.
It's a gigabyte. Mm-hmm. So, summary. HTOR now nested and supports array. So we have a document-based model. So you can just store in HTOR your books. Books with chapters, sections, figures, images, subscriptions to images, and effectively work with this. Access to specified field, So success by k is fast. It's because of the binary representation. It can use GIST and gene indexes. JSON users can use a functional gene index and get considerable speed up. In our example, you see the two orders of magnitude. This binary representation can be used by JSON. So it's a room for the future. So that's why our talk is a one step forward, real true JSON data type. So binary representation is ready. We have one binary representation and two, how to say, incarnation. It's HStore and JSON. Yes.
So the binary representation supports JSON data types.
No, it's as you see that. You can put. Type support.
Not real type support, but just removing
quotes.
Quotes.
Yeah.
The Boolean type and integer.
So we can just add one bit, which said if we should quote or not quote, not to quote. Yeah. So here is our plans. As we've seen, the HStore input can be improved, should be improved maybe a bit. We need some query language because complex structure needs some regular way to work with this.
When I'm thinking about XPath or JSON, there is
jQuery, yes.
Yeah,
so that's why we need to understand what we need to implement, you know. Or just use a TS query, we can use a H query. That is what we still didn't decide. Need some research. Yeah, I think that we need some simple subset. We don't need to implement like XPath, you know. It's too complex.
Useful
subset. That's where community should help us.
We need to support dimensions from XPath, but we probably need to support at least a tree-structured language that's going to be similar in other respects. We can talk about it.
Yes. So another thing we would like to work is a better indexing, because now we index keys and values separately, and keys does not have a, how to say, information about level.
About path.
Yes.
With using SPGIS, you can encode path in the tree path, but it requires a serious work to replace B3
engine.
A lot of space and encoded the path
keys with path. If we do not right now, we'll have a very big index because we have a lot of duplicated information. But with something like, how you say, radix tree, we can save this encode the path store in the radix tree.
Prefix
tree, yes. But this is also interesting task for us. We have no statistics support right now. This is very challenging task because we need some research about correlation between keys and values. I think that we hope that Sash Karatkov will work on this. This is very difficult. And type support. Type support is the questions because, for example, I would like to have type support, but Theodore, ask if somebody explain him why we need type support. We will
the idea is that polymorphism in Postgres doesn't allow to have two identical operations different only in returning type. So for each type we will need to introduce new operator. The same problem on
yes.
SQL you can't get some type except text and JSON right now.
Mm-hmm. So of course we need to write a documentation. This is always the problem for us. Because you've seen that it's a bit complex, and if you try to explain everything, it will be like a book. And we hope to submit patch for 9.4. Don't know. We need to understand to decide what we do, where to stop, because a lot of plans. We need to decide what to stop. Maybe we need just to submit something which could be useful for JSON. And
pretty
and work on the binary representation to JSON and index support. I don't know who will do this. Yes.
Well, the problem is going to be upgradability.
Right? Yeah.
Binary representation in JSON and BJSON, which share the
syntax. With the braces. Confused?
We will have to document that strongly. You can't rely on the order being the same for the key you input and output.
It should be.
Look, it looks like why my select doesn't keep order of insertion.
I think order is probably important. Sorry.
Yeah.
I mean, no one, I think we've got some serious
I don't understand. So you. Okay, so we understand that, but this is not for HStor. HStor historically, you know, it's just a string. And what we're talking about JSON. JSON, of course, will support supports types, data types. So I see no problem. Or what you say talking about put HStor output to the application. How?
No, if you share the representation,
No, not share it. No, you can. We can just add, as Theodore said, additional bit, which. Brackets. Yeah. So no problem for.
I mean, just even right now, you could just end up, you know, pulling your type out and just casting it, which, you know, you have to pay the performance penalty of doing the cast. But I mean, it's a way around it. I think the nice reason to have it.
But not if you're converting the whole long complicated query to JSON.
Well, that plus, I mean. I think where the type support would be particularly useful is with the querying, because I might be trying to query something that's an integer, query something that's an array. You'll be able to do
strategies
like that.
If we do predicates, if the query language will support predicates, you need types, because we need to know if it's it is greater than 13 or more, like,
yeah.
That's, yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and Lozi.
And one of them uses a heuristic method to say, okay, this looks like a number, so I'm not going to quote it. Or this looks like a Boolean, so I'm not going to quote it. And everything else gets quoted. And the strict form, which is what the class uses, actually quotes everything. Because it says, well, it's HStor, it's string, so I'm just going to quote it. So you actually get, we actually have provided some choice there already.
But it's not the. Not very good option, because string T will become to Boolean very good true.
Yeah. Sure. No, it's a heuristic. It's not 100%.
Sure. You store in there is null and is HStor, right? In the structure, you store flags.
Is array and is array and
is hash. That's nice.
Programming language parsers, if you parse into internal structures, you get another. Like if you parse the JSON into Python, you can't rely on the order.
Yeah.
Unless you use a order to take a parser, and then you can. But by default, you can't.
So, in
general,
you have two flags, null and nested. So,
yeah, maybe.
If you take the two bits and use them as four different dumps, 0, 1, 2, 4, you get null, nested, string.
And 1, 3. Okay, yes.
So one thing I know this might be.
Good idea.
So, like, I know this might be difficult because there's, like, you know, legacy system issues, but, you know, between both the HStor type and the JSON type, they're overlapping operators, but they're represented differently. I mean, and I understand with HStor, the arrow operator, that you have to support the legacy, you know, basically legacy HStor type that you have set up. But for instance, I think it was the array retrieval one, that's just like the JSON one, but it's different types. I think, from the end user perspective, the particularly since we are going to have two closed systems for a bit, it'd be nice to try to keep a little bit consistent again. I don't know how feasible that would be, but it's a minor thing. But like in terms of like advocacy efforts and like teaching people how to use it, it'd be nice if there's some level of consistency. And I'm sure when you're doing the indexing type stuff, when that comes,
looks like the best solution is to left HStore and not one more variable, but left old HStore as is and put some new HStore, new generation. And for HStore 2, like TCH, TCH2.
Yeah, JStore.
JStore. Yeah, very nice. JStore. So this is what we, we just show what we did, and now we need the help of community to, because we did for to make you happy, but but there are so many choices.
Yeah, I mean it's almost immediately useful for me. If we're ready today, I could use it. I already have problems. So I do run both HStore and JSON in like the same database in my live production application. To take advantage of both of their features, where I need it.
I mean, one of the things we're going to need to decide is where it's going to go. Is it going to go in the core, or is it going to be in the core?
Yes.
Because, we know pretty well that by now that moving types that are not core types into the core is actually fairly difficult.
Yes, that can be. So we can just call a new data type JStore for the core, and HStore will be remain like extension.
I don't know. What's the advantage of having
Yeah, we should have this in the core, because if we want JSON has a binary representation, JSON is in core. It could not be relied on the extension.
Yeah.
So probably we should think about a new data type JSTOR. I like this JSTOR. Actually, this is the last. So availability. You can download this patch and play with all this stuff. I think that you can just cut and paste queries. And here's the thanks. I should say that we are very grateful to the Engine Yard. Engine Yard supported us, so and they want to continue support. So that's all. If you have any questions,